I think it always bodes well when you applaud before I speak. So right now, really happy. I think as Diane said earlier, as the day goes on, you think, I better not put that in. That made me think of this, or that made me think of something else. There's a sort of confluence of ideas happening in Scotland. But for me, there has been for a while. But we haven't quite landed them all yet. We talk a lot about them. Okay. So, I am not an academic, which will become apparent to you as this unfolds over the next half hour or so. I am not an educationalist. I'm certainly not an elected member. I never want to be. I have far more fun poking elected members than I do actually doing anything else. But I'll tell you what I am. I'm Anita's husband. Have been for 42 years. I'm Laura's dad. I have been for 35 years. I'm Rachel's dad. I have been for 30 years. And I'm about to be a granddad in May. So that's my credentials. So I want to just establish with you some baseline as we go along here. Although I should say, what I've done for a while is I've tried to make sense of what academics say, because I'm not the brightest boy in the world. And so I sometimes have to ask several questions so that I'm sure we're talking about the same thing. Because I've been at conferences before and meetings before, and we used to call people the super agreeables. You know, yes, I understand that. And no, they don't. So when I was, I've been lucky enough to hook into some really smart folk and ask them when, I mean, George, for instance, George Hoskins, in fact, to see, George was one of the first people we grabbed when we were thinking about violence prevention. Suzanne Zeedyke, that was on the film. Richard Tremblay, we had him over here. Mary Gordon, we brought him here in 2007. I brought her here in 2007. Mark Bellis, Vincent Felitti, who developed the adverse child, we brought him here in 2007. The police brought him here. We brought him here. Violence since 1990-something has been a public health issue. They didn't realise that until we told them. And then 10 years later, they're now starting to do something about it. So this notion that there's a confluence of ideas, there is, but we're still in our silos. And when people ask me to speak about gangs, for instance, because I've got some experience in that area, I always need to clarify, which gangs do you want me to speak about? Do you want me to speak about health and social services and police and education? Or do you want me to speak? Because when we're speaking today, and all of the language has been used today about relationships and conflict, apply as much and even more to these great monolithic services that are there. Because they're territorial. They guard their own budgets. They have their own language. They think they're smarter than everybody else. They're the only people that can do it. And we need to break that down. And the way we do that is relationships. Because I don't deal with health. I deal with Mark Bellis. I don't deal with education. I deal with Keir Bloomer, or I deal with whoever. It's people. That's what makes a difference. So I want to get on a sort of baseline so that we're all on the same page. I suspect we are. It's always worrying when you come to these things, because we're all like-minded. I do fewer conferences now, because when people say, "Will you come and speak?" And I think, well, I spoke to you 3 years ago. What do you think I'm going to say is different? And what have you done about what I said? Because we congregate in our own little groups and reassure ourselves we're all doing the right thing. So you need to leave here today with something to say, I'm going to do something different. Absolutely. I'm going to challenge something and make it better. That's what I'm going to do. So that will be my challenge to you that I hope are very... Good. A very good chair. That great. A very good chair has been taken forward. So here's my question. It's a multiple choice. There are only two choices in it. There's none of these sneaky ones, you know. There's only two choices in it, and you're all pretty smart. So I want you, but think about it. If you get it wrong, you're going to look really daft. Anyway, I want you to put your hand up if you're not a son or a daughter. Cool. So we'll start there. Because we forget that, and we've forgotten that for the past 25, 30, 40, 50 years, where we value systems and processes and business models above being human, above... Oh, your titles in that. Fabulous job titles. Some of them have got verbs in them, so you do things, I would presume. Although, scarily enough, there's a few that don't have verbs in them. But we define ourselves by that, the same way as we often define the people who are trying to help by the service we deliver. So police deal with accused or witnesses or victims. Teachers deal with students or pupils. Doctors deal with patients, clients. It's the same folk. We define them by what we do. It's so bloody arrogant about it, and we need to change that. Because if we think that there's a model that's going to fix this, if we think there's a lever that we can pull that's going to change it, it's not there. And if somebody tells you it is, walk away quickly from them because they're lying to you. Because if there was a lever there to be pulled, it would have been pulled. We know there are some key things we should be doing. We know that the most important 4 years of a child's life are up to age three, and what we do there will affect them all through their life. And yet, we pay little regard to that in terms of how we develop policy. Little regard. When I started doing this, I was a police officer, had been for a long time investigating murders. So I used to use this expression, emerging evidence. And what I meant was I had just found out about it. And so when I found out about adverse childhood events, I thought, why are we not doing something about this? Why, if we know this is, why are we not doing that? And we didn't. So there's a whole range of things that we should be doing. Wales, for instance, are doing great work with adverse childhood events. They're trying to frame all their public policy around adverse childhood events and experiences. Hugely important, and I wish them every success with that. So we need to be trying to do things a wee bit differently. So the bottom line is, The bottom line is, we're born connected and we stay connected. We're built to connect. It's what we do. When mums give birth, they get a spike in oxytocin so they can connect and love their baby. That's what happens. We're built that way. And humans have got huge brains in comparison to other animals. And men's brains are bigger, you just need to live with that. But the reason of that size is not so that we can walk and talk and we can operate things and text and do that. The reason they're the size they are is so that we can establish and maintain relationships. That's why we're top of the food chain. That's the default setting. The default setting is to connect. And when we're disconnected, that's when we have all our challenges. When kids are kicking out in a classroom and we say they're attention seeking, they're connection seeking. They're programmed to do that. They're programmed to connect with an adult consistently in their life that they can trust and will be good for them. That's what they do. But yet we stick to the idea of professional stuff as if it will fix it in strategies. When we look, for instance, at job descriptions, you'll get great job descriptions and they'll have these things, person specs, they'll have these things in it. They always have that in it. It's an endless list. You can put anything you like in it. Why is it we never put that in it? Why is it we never think that these things are important? Because I think what we do is we presume because we're recruiting a human, they'll bring those things along with them. They don't. And if they do, we sometimes beat it out of them. We sometimes describe human behaviour. Like, for instance, the classic is teachers are not allowed to cuddle kids. You know, they're not allowed to do that. That would be unprofessional. Really? A human comforting another smaller human when they're in distress is unprofessional. I'm immigrating. That's no right. And we need to challenge that. And isn't it interesting that in big organisations, the only department that's got human in its title is human resources. Yeah, there's an irony in there. Because we presume these things are there, so we need to start and value these things. And not try and make ourselves seem smarter by the number of how many letters we have, or what our job title is, or how much we earn, or where we are. If you think about the people that you work with, I bet you the ones who stick out are the ones who are professional and technically proficient and understanding, but I bet you they're also really good humans. I bet they're also the folk who are connected. Those are the people who are really successful. Those are the ones you hook into. Those are the ones that will change the world and are already doing it. Because when you get into that, it sucks the life out of you. If you're working in a big organisation, it sucks the life out of you. Health, for instance, I heard somebody talk about health and CAMHS. I can imagine the frustration that's involved in that. Health, the largest employer in Europe. Huge. And we just lose our way a wee bit in it. We just lose our way. We have to get back to something that needs to be there. So some personal stuff. And lots of you, sometimes when I give this, it's a surprise to folk. They don't understand it. You'll all understand this. But I don't care. I'm saying it anyway. When I was head of CID in the East End of Glasgow, it was early 2000s. In those days, we could have six murders on a weekend. We could have six young men killed on a weekend. And it was usually young men. And it would be usually young men who lived nearby and who knew them briefly or knew them remotely, and they lived no far away. It'd be a single stab wound to the upper torso. They'd be dead. That's what happened. And we were fabulous at investigating them. Fabulous at it. because we had loads of practice and we were dealing with the feckless and the stupid. That's who we were dealing with. Berlini is full of feckless people. It's no Moriartys and master criminals that are there. They're not there. And you should remember too that everyone who's in Berlini and every prison in the UK has also been in a classroom. They're there. Nobody's hiding from us. So I would be at home, because murders usually happen at 2 a.m. Although I did find out later on that in fact they happened earlier than that, but they waited until 2 before they phoned me. So I'd be home. I'd be home, cosy pie beside Anita, thriving. Absolutely great. And the phone would go. So I'd answer the phone. It'd be the duty officer. Sir, we've got a murder in Ballanock. I could tell you where it would be. It was seldom you had a murder in Newton Mearns. It was seldom you had a murder in... Anyway. And I'd say, okay, and I'd sit up and I'd put the light on and I'd start to take some notes and ask some questions. So I'd started to move from there into there. I started to cope with what was happening for me. Doing that, because I was trained, I was experienced, that's what I did. Then I'd say, okay, I'll be there in about 45 minutes. I'd get in the shower, say goodbye to Anita, who usually didn't even wake up. No tea and toast before you leave, John, take care, none of that nonsense. Just keep the noise down, John. And then I'd be driving in, and as I'm driving in, I would be starting to think about stuff that was happening, things I'd need to do, what else would happen. And I'd start to think and worry about stuff. I'd remember that the DS who's on duty, he's a bloody maniac. He'll have done something outrageous. No. So I start moving from that coping into just coping. I can't get there quick enough. And then I used to turn into the back of London Road Police Office, just along from Parkhead, and I'd be reversing my car into my bay, and the back doors would open. The CID were always in the ground level. They never put us 2 or 3 floors up in case we just wanted to jump out the windows. But anyway, we're always on the ground level. And about 6 or 7 people would come out the back door, coming towards me, usually at a tilt. And they would all be, you know, a phalanx of detectives, all want to tell me something. All want to tell me something that was really important. And then I moved right into that chaos notion. That's where I was. Chaos, because that's where they were. That moment when it was just, oh, bloody hell. And I always did the same thing. Put the kettle on. Because whoever's deceased is deceased. Let's have a cup of tea. And they'd all have a cup of tea, and we'd sit down, and then we'd start to learn what we knew, where we were, what we were going to do, and it just, and we moved right back down into coping. We never quite got to the thriving stage, but we got back into coping with that, and we started to do it. But you know the interesting thing? All the really hard decisions had been made long before John Wayne rode over the hill. The difficult decisions had been made by the youngest cops on the street. The ones who were just out of Tully Allen, deciding, first of all, is it a murder? Is the accused here? Are they still alive? Should I be? Is there witnesses here I should keep? What size is the crime scene? Because forensics is hugely important. What about CCTV? All those decisions were made long before the 24-year-old veteran detective murder investigator rode over the hill. They made me look good. They were all done. And that's really important. It's really important in this idea of policy and strategy. Don't think about somebody else doing these things for you. We all have a role to play. Leadership's a behaviour, it's not a role. But all those kids and all those young cops, I knew who they were, they knew me. I'd spoken to them at briefings at the start of their shifts over the months and said, this is what I expect, this is what I don't expect. And I always said to them, it's okay to make a mistake. I actually used another expression, but it was okay to make a mistake. Blame is no for anything other than no asking for help or no giving help. That's what blame's for. It's no for anything else. And I think there's a danger too in lots of our organisations and sometimes in the country where we create an echo chamber where everything's just fab, you know? And we need to get by that. We need critical friends speaking uncomfortable truths. You know that idea of Hume? David Hume said that truth springs from argument among friends. Well, we need to remember that. You need to be able to fall out with people without actually falling out with people. You need to be able to say things out loud. So we bumped into Harry Burns when we started doing this, because he was director of public health in Glasgow. And when we found out violence was a health thing, we tried to give him it. We said, what are you doing about this, Harry? Nothing was the retort. But at that time, Harry had been trying to work out, he had been a cardiovascular surgeon, and he had been trying to work out why it was that some people from some parts of Glasgow took longer to recover from procedures than people from other parts of Glasgow. He was trying to work that out. And so really smart. He kept at it, and we kept working with Harry all the way through. When Harry became the chief medical officer, in his first annual report, there was a section on it on violence, written by the Violence Reduction Unit. The first time ever. Scotland was one of the first countries to start using public health to deal with violence, bullying and suicide. There weren't many health people on board with it, but they are a wee bit better now. But it didn't matter, it was the model we were using. So, Harry found some work that had been done by a guy called Aaron Antonovsky. Now, Antonovsky had looked at a cohort of people who had been born in the, during the Holocaust in the camps, or had been children in the camps. And he wanted to find out what they were like in adult life. How had that impacted on their lives? And as you would imagine, for the vast majority of them, life wasn't very good for them. It was very poor. Lots of them had poor health. But there was a small number who were absolutely fine. So good old Aaron had a look at them. You know how in Scotland, we're always looking at the things that make us ill and not the things that make us healthy. You know, the idea that every silver lining does indeed have a black cloud. You know that one? So we thought, he did that. And what he found was that these people had, that were doing well, had certain things that were common to them all. And he called it a sense of coherence. And first of all, your world is structured, predictable, explicable. That you have the internal resources to meet the demands that come to you, towards you, and that you recognise those demands as challenges worthy of investment. So that was Antonovsky and Harry Burns. And when I heard John speaking this morning about parents, that notion of control, and I mean, I had always thought, where I see it mostly, I mean, that was me driving into London Road Police Office, starting to lose a bit of control. The other place you notice it is when you're going on holiday, yeah? Because particularly during the school holidays, because there's families together that haven't been in the same room for longer than 2 hours a week, for 5 or 6 months, and you can actually touch the tension. You can feel it at airports. That's why I no longer travel when they're traveling. I travel at different times, yeah, and hopefully in a different class of plane when we're going. But you can actually touch the tension. You can touch it because it's, where's the ticket? Seven, okay, I've got the money, what do we, where's it waiting? That sort of stuff. And the other thing that you can relate this to is if you think about prison, sometimes you get the headline, particularly in the Daily Mail, that said, prison's so soft, people would rather be inside than outside. That's how soft prison is. Flat screen TVs. You can't buy any other kind, incidentally, but anyway, flat screen TVs. The headline should actually read, my life is so shit on the outside, I'm happier in here. Because if I come out, I'm going to be homeless. I'm going to be exposed to risk from violence. There'll be alcohol, there'll be drugs. I'll have no money, I'll have no relationships and no connection. So why the hell would I no rather be in the jail where I've been before and I sort of understand what's happening? That's what happens, but we see it in a different way. It's like seeing the kids who demand attention are actually looking for connection. Just see it in a different way. And it's the same with violence. When George was speaking this morning about violence, and I use George's stuff all the time. Richard Tremblay, when he was here, we went for dinner with him. I was trying to make sense over it. I hope over a glass of wine he would have said stuff that I'd understood more than he did when he was lecturing. But I was saying to him, how is it that people learn to be violent? And he said, he switched the light on for me. He said, no, you need to think of it in another way. We learn how not to be violent. We learn to negotiate, to communicate. We learn to compromise. We establish relationships and empathise. Therefore, the need for violence becomes the last option in a tactical menu. We all have that capacity for it. We all have it there, particularly men, because violence is a man thing in the main. But for lots of young people, they don't have those options, so they don't leave home in the morning saying, right, I'm going to be violent today. I'm going to be aggressive. That's not how it works. It's not that cognitive notion that's there. That's why the early years are hugely important. So that, for the creation of health, needs to be comprehensible, manageable, and meaningful, or you're living in a stressful environment. The parent who's living with a teenager I was picking up on today, the adolescent. I meant to ask John if he's still here. My wife reckons there are several phases of adolescence and I've gone through at least another four. You know, there's the one, the biological one that happens, you know, when you take risks, you fall out of trees, you try all sorts of things. In Glasgow, what you do is you run in a gang, you carry it, you know, you try drugs, you try a whole range of things. And if you don't get to jail and you don't become an addict, you don't become an alcoholic and you don't get any chip marks, you make great policemen. That's where they end up. Not them all, but some. Because that was one of the reasons we've taken to importing them now from south of the border. Inequality is another big issue. I said earlier about relationships and about the most important 4 years. Another huge thing is violence against women. If we don't fix violence against women, we'll never fix violence. We just won't. That's the nexus where we can do something about it. That's the nexus where we can actually help. We should be working there. This is this is from the spirit level. You'll have seen this. But this notion of the most unequal countries in the world are the most violent. Look where the USA is. Yeah? They're the most violent. But what's interesting is, if you look at that same curve, or that same slope, it also applies to social determinants. The point, I think, a colleague was saying from health earlier, about diseases of modernity, loneliness, addictions, depression. There's no clinical responses to these, or some. The clinical responses are limited. The responses are human and relationships. Loneliness. You don't get, I mean, that's about relationships, for goodness sake, it's there. So if you understand that, this is Marmot's work, Sir Michael Marmot, Social Determinants of Ill Health. When you see that list there, what you should be looking at is, there's a list of partners. There's a list of people who are all wanting to work in the same area as you to do the same thing. That's how you identify the collaboration. Who else is working in this? So if I'm trying to reduce violence, and I know that early years is important, God, look at the partners I've got. Now, they don't always know they're going to be partners until you tell them. But we're all on the same journey. We're all on the same journey. And that's how we do it. So the notion of that is that coalition of the willing. It would be great if we had a big plan. And remember, we've established that. I hope we've established that. There isn't a lever. There's no big plan. Milestones. It's not going to happen like that. It just ain't. We need to start where we are and do what we can. That's what we need to do. It's our job to do that. We've left enough problems for the next generation. Laura and Rachel have got enough problems to deal with. We've left them, thanks very much. Planet might not even be here, for goodness sake. That's an issue. So it's our job to make this better. And see for your own well-being, and you already know this. If you come into your work every day to fix it, you're going to go home at night usually disappointed. Drink a lot of wine, that's what happens normally with that. But if you're going to your work every day trying to make it better, make it better, even if it's just for one person. And if that one person someday just happens to be you, that's cool as well. There's loads of work to go around. Just lean into it. This morning, I'd written down a note when, I can't remember who was speaking, and there's a Buddhist proverb about saying that we often pass unseen through little moments of other people's lives. You don't. You're there sharing moments of other people's lives and trying to make them better. That has to be hugely satisfying. Hugely satisfying. Hugely frustrating as well. But like we were talking about all the negative things we say about adolescence, you'll think about all the negative things and go, oh, we just did this, we just did that. And you forget to celebrate the things. There'll be people outside today living good lives and being as good as they can be because somebody like you took an interest in them. I always say the Geely Peace Club in Castle Milk, there are young boys who are alive and not in the jail for murder because of the Geely Peace Club. Now, I don't have the evidence and can say there's who it is. They don't write cards and say, thank you, I never killed this man because you helped me. They don't do that. But it happens. That's what happens, that adult. So when we start to do that why we're doing things, why are we doing it? Why are you doing this? Because it's not just about money. Can it be just about that? That's part of it for some people. But if we understand why we're doing it, we'll understand where we might get some partners to help us do it. And it's not about always working together. It's just about understanding the direction of travel, understanding where we're going. It's not about saying we need to work together at every step of the way. I don't want to be I was a cop. I didn't want to be a social worker. I didn't want to be a teacher. But I understood what I could do and the limits of what I could do. Teachers just now, I think, are finding it challenging because we put the notion of inequality onto teachers. We talk about inequality, raising attainment, and equity, and child poverty as if it's all the same thing. And as if you're going to fix it in a classroom. You're not. And teachers need to step up and say, here's the stuff we do really well, and we're good at that. Here's the stuff we do really well if we get some help. And see this stuff here? We can't do that. We can't do it. And we need to be brave enough to say that. And when we're talking about engaging with parents, James Heckman, who's a Nobel laureate in economics, said, a major determinant of successful schools is successful families, because teachers only work with what parents provide. And if teachers don't start engaging with parents, it's not going to happen. The point that was made, I think, when the minister was speaking, it's just not going to happen. This is a leadership thing as well, I suppose. Tolstoy said that. History is made up of that, an infinitely large number of infinitesimally small actions. But because of this policy strategy thing, we need to chip big lumps. Well, it's only down 1%. 1% meant by a life, it's a person. So Tolstoy said that. So, him, he's my hero. Do you remember this? Mid-80s, some of you will, some of you sadly won't. Tiananmen Square. The couple of days before, there had been demonstrations in the square, put down with some brutality by the regime that was there. A couple of days later, the tanks are rolling into the square. Your man's there, and he thinks, that's not right. What can I do about that? I know. And he stood in front of the tank. Good old tank man. Because what he did when he stood in front of it, the tank tried to reverse and go around him, which was really stupid in a square because he just did that. He did that. And eventually climbed onto the tank and spoke to the humans inside it. He did that. Now, there wasn't a policy for that or a strategy. Certainly wasn't a risk assessed. He just said, what can I do about that? I can do something about it. This is all I can do. It's not going to fix it. I'm not going to stop the tanks. I'm not going to change the regime. But hey, I'm going to do something about it. And he did. And sometimes we need to stand in front of the tanks. And it's no easy. It's no easy. You need to speak your truths quietly. But they need to be said out loud. The thing I like best about him is he's got two bags of shopping. Is that not cool? His wife will be sitting in a flat somewhere going, he left here 45 minutes ago at the shops. And then he'll come in and say, I'm sorry, I'm late, darling. There's a couple of tanks in the square. She'll go, all right. And that's just in case you thought it was only one tank. Just in case you thought, ah, oh, Kendi could stand in front of a T-20. That's what he was standing in front of. That's what that guy did. That's what he did. Now, luckily, the Scottish government doesn't have access to tanks. But sometimes that metaphor applies, and think about that guy standing in front of the tank, and sometimes you'll need to do that. Any change needs relationships. If you don't have relationships, then it's people and attitudes. No policy, it's people and attitudes that change the world. That's it, nothing else. People and attitudes, that's what do it. You, that's what does it. And that idea that hope changes everything, that's a human thing. It changes everything. If we don't have hope, it's hopeless. And I'll tell you a story about him. When we were doing the gang stuff, Kenny McCaskill was still justice, and he phoned up and said, or the PA phoned up, would you speak to Mr. McCaskill, who'd given us some money? So I said, of course. I could have been, I mean, I'm not cheap, but I can be bought. So I was speaking to him, and he said, look, I've got a friend who's a screenwriter who wants to do something around gangs, really interested in the work you're doing in the East End of Glasgow, could he come and see you? So he did. The guy's name was Paul Laverty. Now, Paul came along and we had a couple of meetings and I took him out to the East End and he met some people in the East End. And the book that he was writing, or the film that he was writing, was called The Angel Share. And he worked with a director called Ken Loach. He also wrote I, Daniel Blake. Paul's a Scots guy, good guy. And while he was there, he gave this guy a job as the star in The Angel Share. His name's Paul Branigan. Paul won a BAFTA. Was in River City. Was in a film later on. The second film he did was with Scarlett Johansson. Paul was a methadone baby. Paul was serving a 7-year sentence in Pullman when he was 17 for violence. And a prison officer there said, you're going to be here a while, son. You need to get involved in some stuff. What are you going to do? So eventually he got involved in some football because he was good at football. And the prison officer said, well, look, maybe you should do some certificates so that when you leave, you can actually... But Paul wasn't keen in that. And the reason he wasn't keen, he could barely read and write because he'd been excluded from school. So the prison officer worked with him. Got him newspapers, dictionary, post-its. Write down the word you don't understand and we'll do it. And he did that for him for years. So when Paul came out, he came to us and was working as a volunteer because he had certificates. And when Paul Laverty says, come and meet Ken Loach and read the script, he could read it. And he got a BAFTA. The prison officer didn't say, do this and you'll get a BAFTA. He just said, I'm going to do what I can do. And what I can do is help you to read. And that's what he did. And that's what came out of it. Now, Paul... goes up to Pullman. Now, the only question we ever asked when we go to Pullman is, what was it like snogging Scarlett Johansson, which is a door opener. But And Paul's still on a journey. It's not over for Paul. It's still difficult and challenging for Paul. And there's loads and loads of that. See, when you go to Pullman today, I was saying to George earlier, the last time George was probably at Pullman, there was 800-odd young boys in it, young men, 70-odd percent for serious non-sexual violence. They built a new hall. There's just over 500 in it today. Sorry, just over 400 in it today. And outside on the wall, it says, in letters that are that high, releasing potential. It's an educational establishment with some really challenging pupils. That's what it is. It's how we think about things and how we treat things differently that make the difference. Start to think of them as people. Because every wee boy who's up there, or most of them, will already be dads. So we don't define them as prisoners. Define them as what they are. Help them be as good as they can be. Break that cycle that George was speaking about. Vaclav Havel, that's the notion of hope that I always like. It's just a notion, regardless of how it turns out, we're doing the right thing. And helping people in relationships is the right thing. It's hard to like a 19-year-old who stabbed somebody to death. Hard to like them, and I've locked a lot of them up. It's much easier to like that 19-year-old as a 3-year-old who was living in a difficult house and having a difficult life. Much easier to like them then. But at some point, we stop liking. And we need to change that around, break the cycle. So when you think, can we fix it all? No, we can't. We can't certainly do it today, but we can break the cycle. We can change it for some, and we need to be satisfied with that. We can keep pressing and doing the big stuff and asking it to do big stuff, but the truth of the matter is, this is what we need to do, and you need to take some pride in that you're doing that. I'm on the board of the Children's Parliament. Children's Parliament works with kids from about 5 or 6 right up to about 13 or 14. You know that bit we ignore? I mean, the youth services at local authorities are seen as something extra. And early years is there. But we work on them on their rights. And we support them. Difficult kids. And they're fab. We had some of them over very recently, not me, but a couple of them here, had them over in Geneva presenting. These kids presenting stuff. So what we've started this year, because we're 21 years old, we're looking for some unfairties. I'm the chief unfairty, incidentally. Unfairties are adults who will stand up and represent kids, who will listen to them, who will represent them fairly, who will speak out on their behalf, who will challenge things that are unfair for them. So we're looking for unfairties. So visit the website, get yourself in there. We need more unfairties. Yeah, good girl. Yeah. And it's that idea, it's from that, what we don't want at the Parliament was a nest of fearies, remember? So we don't want any fearies. John Swinney's one, Tom Hunter's one, Suzanne Zeedyke. We've got a stack of people there, really important. The governor of Pullman, Sue Brooks, she's an unfearty. She's an unfearty. You imagine as a governor of prison saying, I want to bring in these folk here who are going to teach them about how to play with their wains. Yep. So, really important. So I want you to do that. Sorry, I'm just finishing the movie. I know I'm over. Somebody says that the child is the father of the man, and that, you know, and every man, every child is the adult waiting to come out. Go up into Berlin, and every adult, there's a child that was lost in there somewhere. That's the other side of that. That's the other side of it. And we can make a difference in it. We can. Thank you.